New York's pure rock.
I tried to be a fry cook at a ground round and failed miserably because you had to memorize order numbers and have them all up at the same time. And I thought, well, if I can't succeed as a fry cook, I better do what I do best. And I just have an impulse to make things. And I paint also, but for a short period of time, and then I have to start building things. I can't keep it just on a flat plane. You'll see some of the, you know, paintings at the studio. By a lot of art, you know, I like David Smith and Rothko, but music was really inspiring, so, and that too has a physical empathy, you know, probably even more than sculpture. It makes your hair stand up on end and, you know, makes you want to dance. Remember that high-low show at, what was that, at MoMA? And it seemed to sort of, it didn't seem low enough for me. It seems like they take low stuff and make it high, and I like to take high stuff and make it low. You know, like debauching an icon like a bonsai tree and putting cheese doodles on it is, kind of bringing it down to a dirtier level. And I like the term high-low, but I think it has a different meaning to me, or I have to change the words around.
Mine is high low, and theirs is low high.
So, for a long time there, I was trying to get the same response that music evokes. And I went to art school in Boston at the museum school, and at that time, there were a lot of bands, you know, actually there still are, it's a good music town. So I'd see a lot of music, and then try to take the energy that, you know, existed in the music and take it directly into the studio. And of course, playing music while I was working, but I would work myself into frenzies and get really reckless and intuitive and impulsive and just, you know, pump stuff out.
When I was younger, I was a very serious young man and very serious about my art, but I found that there's nothing worse than a really serious sculptor, and humor started creeping into my work slowly without ever making a conscious decision about it. And I don't consider myself ever, you know, being funny when I want to be, you know, failing at telling jokes or whatever. That would always happen, but I think I just, that's one of the critical aspects of life is humor. If you meet somebody and they don't have a sense of humor, that would be a major drawback. In fact, when I was younger, I didn't know this, but watching other people, it seems like if you wanted to meet a girl, if you were funny, that would be the most important over cool or quiet. You know, if you're funny, that's critical.
I think I do some of my best thinking when I'm not thinking at all. And like I was saying, I like to drive a lot, but you know, on the highway, I've gotten a lot of good ideas just sitting there, and the ideas come in the back of your head. I'm terrible under pressure, you know, so if I'm thinking I've got to come up with something, that never works. I just have to let it go, and it comes in.
When I was in art school, I remember being shown slides of the Minimalists, and I really, at that time, it didn't excite me so much. Now I love Judd, you know, a classmate said, "God, but that's so boring." And then someone else said, "Well, what do you want to jerk off to that stuff?" And I remember being embarrassed because secretly I was thinking, yeah, that would be great. That would be perfect. And that's what art should be like. It could be erotic or sexual.
We have an art spiel, and you know, it's difficult to put a finger on it because I like to be broad and reckless, but one thing that I think works, a formula that works with all art forms, is to be familiar but unpredictable. And if the unpredictable part is really essential, if the viewer can guess what's going to happen, then it's boring. And I really think that in my case, I think boredom is the enemy, and I think that's probably why I make things, is that I'm discontent with functional objects. As an object maker, I think it's critical to have dust collectors that are useless and just sit there and make themselves problematic by having to store them and move them around with you. But with the physical empathy, I like to look at stuff. It could make my teeth feel like they're floating, you know, or I identify it with my body. Conceptually, I like work to be intelligent and stupid at the same time. I think, you know, several years ago, myself and probably a lot of people became dissatisfied with art that was supposed to be smart and failed. So I think it's hitting at a lower gut level of stupidity. I remember when stupid became a good word, at least in art. And, so I like it to be intelligent and stupid at the same time. Like I would consider the bonsai trees with cheese doodles, you know, the cultural clash is smart, but the cheese doodles are clearly stupid and very direct. A better word is dumb, you know, and with my students, I have to clarify a whole language and tell them that they can't be offended if I use the word dumb, you know, to describe their work. Sculpture, in a way, is because it's, at least for objects, are stupid anyway. Like I was saying, sitting around collecting dust, being difficult to move, and not really having a function is a dumb object. So you take that and exploit it.
The real thrill, I think, is inventing, you know, a new invention every day. Hopefully, if you're lucky, you know. Some of those decisions I made a long time ago are just now kind of coming to term in a positive way for me. You know, people like Naumann or Kunz, especially Naumann, who really pioneered change, made it possible for younger people, I think, and I think change is exciting, and change is necessary, and if you can't change, then, you know, you're dead. With my work, I think it's not really for the viewer or anything, but for my personal entertainment. So each time I go into a new series, you know, as long as it entertains me for a while and breaks the boredom, then I'm happy. I think artists really should be inventors.
I've always made objects, but I consider, you know, I like sculpture because it includes everything. It's the broadest category. It includes performance, video. I consider, like, endurance artists falling in that category.
I was always afraid of language and never really felt articulate. I guess this goes with the why are you a sculptor category. And when you're stupid about saying stuff, I guess it's easier to express that in a different way. So I found sculpture is easy to do that without language. Sculpture just sits there, and it's so simple to really, like, a great book is so much different than sculpture, and that's the beauty of sculpture, is that it just sits there and it's simple, and in a way, to me, it was always, the object is always unpretentious. Maybe the artist would be pretentious, but the object itself is so simple and dumb that it's unpretentious. It doesn't really try to do that much other than just sit there in front of you.
Thank you. New York's Pure Rock.